Hello. I'd like to welcome you for another educational lesson from me, Francisco Perez. So today I'm going to go into how the Hawaiian native indigenous was enslaved using the Louisiana Penal Code and was pushed into slavery on these plantations. Let's get into it. So Hawaii's hidden history, slave labor, profit, and the taking of Waikiki. That's the name of this. It's a documentary.
It's very simple. Corporation is in business for one thing only, and that's to make a profit.
Now this is Dillingham. Now everything, if you've been to Hawaii, everything is named after this man. Dillingham this, Dillingham Boulevard, Dillingham Runway Strip, Dillingham this, Dillingham that.
If we get fuzzy in our thinking about that, we're in serious trouble.
You come here as Westerners with a Western point of view, economically, capitalist system, which is based on profit. What does profit mean? One takes more than one gives. That's what profit is.
Hawaiian paradise is a business, an investment for every citizen, which does and must continue to return multi-million-dollar profits in paradise. These profits, in turn, create a better way of life for our people.
This is the story of how Waikiki was transformed from a self-sufficient agriculture community into an economically dependent international tourist destination. It is a story of influential men making and manipulating laws to advance their own self-interest. Our story begins with a description of Waikiki by Archibald Menzies, a naturalist traveling to the Hawaiian island of Oahu with Vancouver in 1792.
The verge of the shore was planted with a large grove of coconut palms, affording a delightful shade to the scattered habitations of the natives. We pursued a pleasant path back into the plantation, which was nearly level and very extensive, and laid out with great neatness into little fields planted with taro, yams, sweet potatoes, and the cloth plant. And the whole was watered in a most ingenious manner by dividing the general stream into little aqueducts, leading in various directions so as to be able to supply the most distant field at pleasure.
The elaborate irrigation system described by Menzies combines sophisticated engineering and conservation techniques that decentralize the water flow of the upland sources. This water distribution method, developed in the 15th century, provided food for hundreds of thousands of people throughout the Hawaiian Islands. Water was considered sacred, and there were taboos or kapu against throwing any waste into the streams, pools, taro plantations, fish ponds, or any fresh water. Human waste was buried or burned. The water was abundant and clean. The land was unpolluted, and the people were self-sufficient.
Patented argan oil formula fuses intensive nourishment, instant moisture. 9 out of 10 women experience...
Only 25 years later, an agent of American missionaries, Levi Chamberlain, describes a dramatic decline in the agricultural productivity of Waikiki.
Our path led us along the borders of extensive plats of marshy ground, having raised banks on one or more sides and which were once filled with water and replenished abundantly with esculent fish, but now overgrown with rushes waving in the wind. I entered into conversation with the natives respecting its present neglected state. They ascribed it to the decrease in population.
The decrease in population was primarily the result of the introduction of disease from early European explorers. The native Hawaiians had no immunity, and the decrease in population was primarily the result of the introduction of disease from early European explorers. The native Hawaiians had no immunity, and the result was mass death of genocidal proportions. The native population collapsed. Waikiki's well-tended taro and fish ponds, tenderly nurtured by Hawaiian labor, would soon become a distant memory. Meanwhile, ever-increasing numbers of Westerners were coming to Hawaii. Some would write of their visit.
Waikiki. There's something in the very name which smacks of the sea. It is a seaside resort of Honolulu, about 5 miles from the city. My friend invited me to take an afternoon drive and left the direction to me. We passed a young coconut grove said to contain 7,000 trees. With such a capacity of the land, what a pity it seems to find oneself soon surrounded by wretched marshes, with muddy ponds, green, and stagnant waters. The hard road goes bravely through and over this country, and soon we reach the giant palms and their covey of nestling cottages. Further along shore, where the native fishing canoes are hauled up on the beach, the cocoa palms grow taller and more numerous, and in comfortable native settlement encamps.
Those comfortable native settlements would soon become the residence for well-to-do Honolulu merchants, as Westerners dispossessed native Hawaiians from their lands through the enactment and enforcement of Western-influenced laws and the subsequent manipulation of the legal system. In 1848, through the enactment and enforcement of Western-influenced laws and the subsequent manipulation of the legal system, well-to-do Honolulu merchants, as Westerners dispossessed native Hawaiians from their lands through the enactment and enforcement of Western-influenced laws and the subsequent manipulation of the legal system. In 1848, one of these laws, the Great Mihele, formulated by a Western attorney named William Lee, was supposedly intended to distribute land equitably. The Mihele may have been great for Western business interests, but it proved to be a disaster for the 70% of the native Hawaiians who lost their land. Shortly after his work on the Mihele, William Lee wrote the Penal Code of the Hawaiian Islands. In an introductory report, Lee states he wrote the code to
prepare a system of laws equally well adapted to the native and foreign portions of our community. One not too refined for the limited mind, the former, and yet enough so to meet the wants and capacities of the latter. Refined for the limited mind, the former, and yet enough so to meet the wants and capacities of the native and foreign portions of our community. One not too refined for the limited mind, the former, and yet enough so to meet the wants and capacities of the latter.
Modeled after the U.S. slave state of Louisiana's penal code, the Hawaiian Penal Code contained a variety of laws designed to put Native Hawaiians at a distinct disadvantage. The Hawaiian Penal Code contained a variety of laws designed to put Native Hawaiians at a distinct disadvantage.
The former, and yet enough so to meet the wants and capacities of the latter.
Modeled after the U.S. slave state of Louisiana's Penal Code, the Hawaiian Penal Code contained a variety of laws designed to put Native Hawaiians at a distinct disadvantage. For example, the new vagrancy laws allowed landless Native Hawaiians to be rounded up and forced to work as slave labor on the sugar plantations. if fines were not paid designed to put Native Hawaiians at a distinct disadvantage. For example, the new vagrancy laws allowed landless Native Hawaiians to be rounded up and forced to work as slave labor on the sugar plantations. If fines were not paid immediately, it meant hard labor in prison or the seizure of property. If more than three people gathered, it could be declared a riot. By the late 1800s, Westerners, though only 9% of the population, owned 67% of the taxable land. Native Hawaiian lands were turned into a commodity to be bought by those with money and lost by those without. The land would be used primarily for a single commercial crop for export, sugar. In 1865, Benjamin Franklin Dillingham arrives in Hawaii. 4 years later, using borrowed money, he buys the Pacific Hardware Company in Honolulu and begins to supply the hardware needs for a growing sugar industry. He marries Emma Louise Smith, the daughter of a missionary, and a year later, Emma gives birth to Mary Dillingham. The heir to the Dillingham Empire, Walter Dillingham, is born 5 years later, on April 5, 1875. The Reciprocity Treaty allowed Hawaii sugar to be imported to the United States duty-free and accelerated the growth of commercial sugar plantations in Hawaii. The need for a transportation infrastructure to serve the needs of this growing sugar industry is not lost on B.F. Dillingham, and in 1888 he obtains a franchise for the Hawaii legislature to build a railroad. A year later he borrows $700,000 and founds the Oahu Railway and Land Company, known as the ORL. In 1892, B.F. Dillingham brings Lucius Pinkham to Hawaii to supervise construction of coal discharging and loading apparatus for the ORL. This job would begin Pinkham's career in Hawaii and his lifetime involvement with the Dillingham family. By the early 1900s, the ORL is operating 160 miles of track on Oahu, and B.F. Dillingham has investments in the five sugar plantations it serves. Sugar production is very labor-intensive. With a declining Native Hawaiian population, Western sugar planters import Chinese indentured laborers. A massive Western sugar planters import five sugar plantations it serves. Sugar production is very labor-intensive. With a declining Native Hawaiian population, Western sugar planters import Chinese indentured laborers. A massive infusion of workers from China, Portugal, and Japan soon followed. For an ever-increasing Asian population, rice is the staple food. The taro and fish ponds of Waikiki are now used for rice production and growing fish. Waikiki once again became a highly productive agriculture and aquaculture area. Even as Waikiki experiences a revival of agriculture and aquaculture, well-to-do Honolulu merchants increasingly take up residence in Waikiki. As a local newspaper reports,
quite a little community of foreign families are now residing at the beach at Waikiki. The distance from town is so short that a person may be in town at his business all day and go out that evening when the change of atmosphere was truly refreshing, while the surf bathing cannot help but be invigorating.
Land values in Waikiki were escalating and cash-poor Asian and Native Hawaiian residents were being displaced by Honolulu merchants. The new residents of Waikiki were clamorous in their demands that the road to Waikiki be improved. The road, later to become Kalakaua Avenue, was widened, and soon an omnibus began providing public transportation to Waikiki. This road to Waikiki and others built during this time became obstacles to drainage. The sophisticated irrigation system built by Native Hawaiians to transport water from mountains to sea and providing public transportation to Waikiki. This road to Waikiki and others built during this time became obstacles to drainage. The sophisticated irrigation system built by Native Hawaiians to transport water from mountains to sea now stagnate. The stagnant water and the introduction of mosquitoes resulted in Waikiki being labeled unsanitary. By the late 1800s, Native Hawaiians, seeing their nation increasingly under the influence of Western businessmen, petitioned Queen Liliʻuokalani for a new constitution to restore more power to the Hawaiian monarchy. Men like B.F. Dillingham, William Owen Smith, and other sugar planters, merchants, and lawyers were part of an oligarchy opposing the Hawaiian monarchy and plotting its overthrow. On January 17, 1893, armed gangs of businessmen, supported by U.S. Marines, illegally overthrew the Kingdom of Hawaii. Sanford Dole was appointed president of the provisional government. The years 1893 to 1898 may be accurately characterized as a period of dictatorship in Hawaii. The problem faced by the oligarchy was how to ensure political control over the non-white people who greatly outnumbered them. As the new Attorney General, William Owen Smith, said,
"These islands are totally unfit for an ideal republic. In general terms, the problem to be solved is how to combine an oligarchy with a representative form of government so as to meet the case."
In other words, how could a small elite group of Western businessmen maintain political control while creating the appearance of a democracy? The answer? A new constitution with restrictive voting laws. The constitution of the Dole Republic was intentionally modeled after Mississippi's constitution, a southern slave state noted for disenfranchising black voters. This new constitution required that
voters must swear allegiance to the Republic.
This law eliminated most Native Hawaiians who favored the monarchy.
Voters and candidates must own property valued at $200.
This also eliminated Native Hawaiians, most of whom were now landless.
The voter must explain the Constitution and be literate in English.
Though many Hawaiians spoke English, naturally most spoke only their own language. Finally, restrictive naturalization laws prevented Chinese and Japanese immigrants from voting. With Native Hawaiian and Asian disenfranchised from the voting process, the Western oligarchy was in the position to pass a series of laws advancing their own self-interests. On March 7, 1893, Walter Francis Freer is appointed Justice of the Supreme Court by the Provisional Government. 5 months later, he marries Walter Dillingham's sister, Mary. Lucius Pinkham was brought to Hawaii a second time by B.F. Dillingham to work as cashier for Dillingham's Pacific Hardware Company. Pinkham, who had no particular expertise in health or medical matters, would be appointed president of the Territorial Board of Health from 1904 through 1906. While president of the Board of Health, Pinkham would continue to be employed as manager of Dillingham's Pacific Hardware Company. In 1902, Walter Dillingham purchases the dredge Caballo from his father's Oahu Railway and Land Company and founds the Hawaiian Dredging Company. 2 years later, B.F. Dillingham's health begins to fail, and Walter assumes control of the various Dillingham enterprises. Known as Mr. Hawaii, Dillingham establishes many powerful contacts during his frequent trips to Washington, D.C. He entertains presidents, senators, and generals at his plush La Pietra estate. These influential contacts become invaluable in obtaining military contracts for his dredging company and in influencing appointments of Hawaii's territorial governors, who were chosen by the President of the United States. Dillingham's estate was located on a Hawaiian place of worship on the side of Diamond Head. In 1906, Pinkham, President of the Board of Health, issues a report called the Reclamation of the Waikiki District.
Honolulu desires a population, omitting the consideration of agriculturalists, such as has made Los Angeles and other towns in Southern California what they are. Persons and residents of private fortunes who seek an agreeable climate and surroundings and who expend large already acquired private incomes. Such persons as we seek desire to find attractive and charming residential districts free from all objectionable features and neighbors.
This report clearly called for turning Waikiki into an upscale neighborhood for free spending rich people. The objectionable features were aquaculture, and the objectionable neighbors were the Native Hawaiian and Asian farmers living in Waikiki. The Waikiki Reclamation Report, ostensibly written by Pinkham, was funded by unnamed sources. Many suspect this unnamed source was Pinkham's employer. The racist sentiment about objectionable neighbors is consistent with other remarks made by Walter Dillingham. When asked his opinion about white men working in the sugarcane fields, he replied,
When you are asked to go out in the sun and go into the canebrake, away from the tropical breeze, you're subjecting the white man to do something that the good Lord did not create him to do. If he had, the people of the world, I think, would have had a white pigment of the skin, and not variegated colors.
The Reclamation Report called made by Walter Dillingham. When asked his opinion about white men working in the sugarcane fields, he replied,
"When you are asked to go out in the sun and go into the canebrake, away from the tropical breeze, you're subjecting the white man to do something that the good Lord did not create him to do. If he had, the people of the world, I think, would have had a white pigment of the skin, and not variegated colors."
When asked his opinion about white men working in the sugarcane fields, he replied,
"When you are asked to go out in the sun and go into the canebrake, away from the tropical breeze, you're subjecting the white man to do something that the good Lord did not create him to do. If he had, the people of the world, I think, would have had a white pigment of the skin, and not variegated colors."
The Reclamation Report called for raising all the land in Waikiki 5 to 7 feet above sea level, and charging the Waikiki landowners, mostly capital poor Native Hawaiians and Asian landowners, to do it.
So they charged the Hawaiians and some of the Asians that have taken to the Hawaiians. They're taken to the Hawaiians and say, "Oh, I love your Hawaiianness. I love everything about you. I want to live near you." And they weren't that crazy. They were cool. So it's like, as long as you're cool, you live around us, because we are very accepting. And then boom, all this land said, "Oh, let's raise it. Let's terraform. This is Hawaii for you." That's why Caucasians, when they comment on bullshit, they go, "If it wasn't for us, Hawaii would still be a desert land." Because they see pictures of barren lands. But those weren't barren. Those were created by the Europeans and made barren. We farmed everything. So get back to this. They want to raise it 7 feet and have the people pay it who are broke. And then, you know how they did? They imprisoned you, put you on plantations if you couldn't pay shit, took your property, harvested all your land. So this is how they got the land in Waikiki. If you couldn't pay for it, they took your shit.
If they were unable to pay the cost, a lien was placed on their land, which was then sold at public auction. The Native Hawaiian and Asian farmers in Waikiki were being forced by law to pay for the destruction of their own livelihoods. Pinkham's report goes on to describe where the fill would come from.
"It has occurred long since to your president to seek the material in the rice or banana fields and swamps themselves. No more desirable, economically workable, or sanitary filling has ever been discovered anywhere. Its depths range from 20 feet to beyond 37 feet. The length of pipeline for delivery is moderate and practicable. The method of dredging would be suction, as employed in the harbor. In order to secure filling material, a great lagoon would, as a consequence, be formed. The filling required would necessitate a waterway nearly 250 feet wide, 20 to 28 feet."
So because they dredged Waikiki so they could build a utopia of buildings that only they live in, this aloha was created, which destroyed the surf. No more 40-foot waves that go a quarter of a mile long.
The report also included information on utilities, transportation, sidewalks, streets, and other amenities of the future Waikiki. This 1906 report would become the master plan for the urbanization of Waikiki, but the massive dredge and fill project would not begin until the 1920s. Meanwhile, there were laws to be passed and land to be acquired. In 1907, Walter Dillingham's brother-in-law, Walter Francis Freer, is appointed governor of Hawaii. During Freer's reign as governor, he appoints a sanitary commission that issues several reports and recommendations regarding sanitation in Waikiki. In October 1911, a single case of yellow fever.
Today, fast forward. Today, there's a sewage spill, or sewage problem, or a sewage break in the main, in the break, in the pipes, every month.
Fever was discovered on a ship arriving from Mexico.
When the thing backs up in the hotels, in apartments, they just flush it into the ocean.
Alarmed that their future business interests could be threatened by negative public health rumors, the Honolulu merchants formed a seven-man civic sanitation committee.
To guard against and handle any possible further occurrence of the disease, and to rid Honolulu permanently of mosquitoes.
Dillingham was chosen to head the civic sanitation committee. No further cases of the disease were ever reported, and according to Dillingham, over $100,000 was spent to control this case of yellow fever. Dillingham's interest in sanitation was not based on selfless public service. His Hawaiian dredging company became the principal contractor and the only
permanently of mosquitoes.
Dillingham was chosen to head the civic sanitation company.
What happened was when because they started this dredging shit, and they created this place that they could create millions of dollars off of. And the tourism industry brings them millions of dollars all alone every year. That it created a stagnant river. See, Hawaiians never, that was like the number one rule. A river always had to flow from mountain to the ocean, which fed the coral reef and created seaweed and new reefs. Allowed the reefs to grow.
The seven-man Civic Sanitation Committee.
To guard against and handle any possible further occurrence of the disease and to rid Honolulu permanently of mosquitoes.
Dillingham was chosen to head the Civic Sanitation Committee. No further cases of the disease were ever reported, and according to Dillingham, over $100,000 was spent to control this case of yellow fever. Dillingham's interest in sanitation was not based on self.
So he had the government put $100,000 on the side for this program. Then he initiates a company that worked directly with the government and received those fundings.
Plus public service. His Hawaiian dredging company became the principal contractor and the only company in Hawaii with the equipment necessary for the massive dredge and fill operation required for mosquito eradication.
And guess what? I still get mosquitoes.
In 1912, a report of the Sanitary Commission to His Excellency, the Honorable W.F. Freer, Governor of Hawaii, was issued. This report expressed concern about yellow fever and malaria, but also revealed a bias towards urbanization.
We believe the wetland problem presents a serious and difficult question, the economic aspects of which cannot be ignored. We are unanimous in the opinion that wet agriculture in the city limits should be stopped. Meanwhile, certain swamps and lowland must be filled in order to protect our public health. Thus, there will be a supply in excess.
So they said, we said this area that is beautiful and marshlands, this is now city. This marshlands is now the city, and now, because I say it's the city, now we must destroy the farms. The farms have no use for us. For why should we give them money? Why should we give them food? Let's fear these farms. Because they are just going to make us sick.
So demand of land for dwellings.
The principal beneficiary of this report would be none other than Walter Dillingham and his Hawaiian dredging company. It was also in the year 19...
That's the shit they do to all these Caucasians and Channelites. They come here and they create businesses and say, Hawaiian this and Hawaiian that. None of these guys is Hawaiian or have Hawaiian values.
In 12, the Dillingham became one of the largest landowners in Waikiki. On September 24th, his dredging company bought 84 acres of shoreline property at the west end of Waikiki from Bishop Estate for $23,000, or $276 per acre. Dillingham got a cut-rate price considering comparable property in Waikiki was being sold at $1,600 to $2,000 an acre. William Owen Smith was president of the Bishop Estate Board of Trustees at the time of the sale to Dillingham. Shortly after the purchase of the Bishop Estate property, Dillingham and Smith formed the Guardian Trust Company and purchased an additional 146 acres of Waikiki hinterlands from the Queen's Hospital for $60,000, or $411 an acre. This land, known as the Macaulay Tract, was subdivided and sold for residential use. This close relationship between Dillingham and Smith and the cheap price they paid for land suggest actions basically unethical that may be likened to the looting of Native Hawaiian landed charitable estates by entrepreneurial capitalists. By the mid-1900s, the property Dillingham purchased from Bishop Estate was worth millions. It became one of the largest shopping centers in the United States, the Ala Moana Center, and the 38-story Ala Moana Hotel. In the 1980s, Ala Moana Center would be sold to Japanese investors for $370 million. From 1913 to 1918, Lucius Pinkham, the Dillingham's former bookkeeper and past president of the Board of Health, serves as governor of Hawaii. Pinkham signs three major laws that further the Waikiki Reclamation Project. The passage of these laws during Pinkham's reign as governor advanced the goals of his 1906 Waikiki Reclamation Report. Charles McCarthy was appointed governor of Hawaii in July 1918 and served until July of 1921. McCarthy owned 6 acres of Waikiki land and, like Pinkham, had close ties to Dillingham. After his stint as governor, he worked for Dillingham doing special work in connection with the Waikiki Reclamation Project. The Reclamation Commission appointed by Pinkham met with Governor McCarthy in July 1918 and studied the matter until September. Ultimately, 161 acres, including government land, were acquired for the canal's 800-foot right-of-way. On December 1, 1920, bids were solicited for the dredge and fill project. The only dredge in Hawaii was owned by Dillingham, and on December 23rd, the bid was awarded to Dillingham's Hawaiian Dredging Company. Under this and associated contracts, Dillingham built the Alawai Canal and used the excavated material to fill in Waikiki. The Territory of Hawaii and City and County of Honolulu paid Dillingham over $100,000 to dredge the canal and fill in the McKinley High School site. Part of the contract allowed Dillingham to keep and sell the extra fill material. The completion of this contract left Dillingham with 2,400,000 cubic yards of fill to sell to individuals who were required by law to fill in their land. At the usual price of 59 cents a cubic yard,
so do you get
Dillingham
that?
Of this contract left.
Do you understand? They took all the farms and they filled it and they built schools. And they built airports and government facilities and military bases. And then the rest of the people who had land that have farms in them, with taro farms and all different types of farms, they said, well, you can't have farms anymore. You have to fill them in. That's law. If you don't abide by law, we will take your land. It's up to you, savage.
Dillingham with 2,400,000 cubic yards of fill to sell to individuals who were required by law to fill in their land. At the usual price of 59 cents a cubic yard, Dillingham stood to gross nearly $1.5 million for this fill material. All this dredging and filling was not without cost to the farmers in the area. Farms and fish ponds near the dredging sites suffered damages to fish, crops, and other animals from the leaking seawater used in the dredge and fill operation. One Chinese tenant, Farmer Chang Fao, describes the damage done to his farm.
When the lands adjacent to my farm were gradually being filled, the salt water escaped into my fish ponds and killed all the fishes in them. Then when my flock of 500 ducks swam about the ponds and ate the dead fish floating in them, they got ill and died at the rate of 20 to 30 every day. Until now, I have only about 100 of them left. The ducks die in such a number every day that I have not have time to bury them fast enough. And in the course of a day or two, worms began to creep out of these carcasses, and when my chicken, numbering over 100, ate these worms, most of them got sick and perished. Before the salt water flooded my farm, I used to have a daily gross income of $12, $10 from egg production, and $2 from fishes caught in the ponds. Although it cost me about $10 per day for overhead expenses to feed the livestock as well as my family, I was about to save about $2 per day, which money, as you know, goes toward paying off the rental and taxes on the farm. But now, with my sources of income completely cut off, I find it very hard for me to keep my family of six children going.
Chang Fao was given only $250 by the Hawaiian Dredging Company. Other farmers, both Asian and Native Hawaiian, received only token payment for their losses and nothing for the destruction of their livelihoods. On October 17, 1928, Dillingham's Hawaiian Dredging Company ran an advertisement in Honolulu Advertiser, Special Waikiki Edition. The advertisement read,
"Hundreds of acres of swamplands reclaimed into what is now one of Waikiki's finest districts. Today there are beautiful homes where once a swamp existed. Hundreds of acres of land were filled in and a broad canal cut through from the sea to the territorial fairgrounds. With the development of the boulevard, which will run the full length of the canal, and the many fine homes and the palatial hotel which are planned for this district, it will without doubt be one of the most attractive sections of the city. The dredge Kivalo lifted its first mud and coral from the canal bed on January 30th, 1922. After 5.5 years of work, it had dug a canal 3 miles long, with an average depth of 25 feet, and a breadth of 250 feet. During this 5.5 years of operation, 1,750,000 cubic yards of material were removed and distributed over hundreds of acres of swampland. $1,500,000 invested in the future of Honolulu reclaimed land worth many millions more. The reclamation of this land was a great project and an important factor in making Waikiki the beautiful residential district that it is today."
Although many changes have occurred since the Waikiki Reclamation Project, it was this project, done under the guise of sanitation, that was the pivotal force that transformed Waikiki into the international tourist destination that we see today. But was the Reclamation Project a success? Is Waikiki more sanitary? Is it a better place to live or visit? Does Waikiki afford a better livelihood and greater self-sufficiency? Has its urbanization benefited the citizens of Hawaii as a whole, and the Native Hawaiians in particular? Let's take a look.
Tourism is emerging as Hawaii's dynamic growth industry with a limitless horizon for the future. It can make Hawaii's golden age come true. The dawn of this golden age of opportunity is within reaching distance. There were 604,000 visitors in 1965 who spent $265 million. We anticipate 700,000 in 1966 spending $302 million, 870,000 in 1968 spending $376 million, and a million or more persons a year spending $432 million in 1970. This is the potential that makes tourism the key to the new Hawaii.
According to court documents submitted by the Sierra Club Legal Defense Fund in its successful suit against the city and county of Honolulu, 72 million gallons of human sewage containing 70% solids is flushed from 206,000 toilets into the ocean a mile and a half off Sand Island every day. 50% of these solids, or 36 million gallons, rise to the surface within 3 to 5 minutes. This is three times the amount of oil spilled by the Exxon Valdez. Prevailing ocean and wind currents transport this pathogen-laden sewage directly into Ala Moana Park, Magic Island, and Waikiki itself. The Mānoa Stream and the Alawai Canal have been described as sinks of environmental pollution by Bruce Anderson, Deputy Director for the State Department of Health. In 1990, the U.S. Department of Fish and Wildlife reported that fish in Mānoa Stream, which flows directly into the Alawai Canal, contains 40% more lead than the national average. Alawai canoe paddlers are often subjected to boil-like sores and staphylococcus infections. In the mid-1960s, the Hawaii Visitors Bureau targeted 1970 as the landmark million visitor year.
The need will require 10,000 more hotel rooms. Will almost double the number of
industry. Heard that. 1960s, 432 million a year.
The employees.
That little place that they destroyed all the farm.
It will also mean more jobs and more money and a wider circulation of the tourist dollar. To get a million visitors a year to Hawaii, will require bigger planes, more flights, more cruise liner trips.
Over a decade later, with nearly 7 million visitors a year, Waikiki has become an overcrowded concrete jungle, replete with high crime, traffic congestion, and street peddlers on every corner. Honolulu City Manager Jeremy Harris described Waikiki as having a Tijuana-style atmosphere. The population density in some sections of Waikiki is greater than Hong Kong's. The jobs created by the tourist industry pay the lowest wages in the state. Friends of the Waikiki Improvement Association took out two full-page ads in the May 17, 1994 edition of the Honolulu Advertiser, complaining about peddlers, prostitutes, and drug dealers assaulting people on the streets of Waikiki. As Stanley Hong stated as he stepped down from his 11-year position with Hawaii Visitors Bureau, Waikiki suffers from too little planning and thought. Tear Waikiki down and start all over. Plans are underway for a huge convention center being built in expectation of a 33% rise in tourism by the year 2000. What about the fortunes of the Dillingham Empire? Walter Dillingham's Hawaiian Dredging Company received virtually every major contract for dredge and fill operations on Oahu. By 1957, Dillingham destroyed over 4,000 acres of natural coastal resource. What about the fortunes of the Dillingham Empire? Walter Dillingham's Hawaiian Dredging Company received virtually every major contract for dredge and fill operations on Oahu. By 1957, Dillingham destroyed over 4,000 acres of natural coastal resources between Diamond Head and Ke'ehi Lagoon. In 1961, the Oahu Railway and Land Company merged with the Hawaiian Dredging Company to form Dillingham Corporation, also known as Dilco. Dilco quickly established itself in the Pacific Rim for both the exploitation of resources and large-scale luxury developments for the affluent classes. As one evictee commented,
Dillinger used to steal from the rich and give to the poor. Dillingham steals from the poor and gives to the rich.
In a 1970 report of Dillingham's activities, the Pacific Study Center concluded,
Dillingham thrives on war, racism, and human misery.
The basis of what Waikiki has become in the latter part of the 20th century was laid in the 1920s, when the decade-long Waikiki Reclamation Project changed the ecology of Waikiki. Waikiki was once a viable and important agriculture and aquaculture area, which was destroyed by profit-seeking capitalist entrepreneurs like Dillingham under the subterfuge of drainage and sanitation.
It is the story of romance and salesmanship and opportunity. It is the story of profit in paradise, but it needs and must have your support. We hope you will be with us as we tackle our fantastic future.